What I want to do in the lecture today is to cover the Kaletskyan and Post-Keynesian tradition. I need to do that not only for completion, because I covered the rise standard macro, of neoclassical Walrasian macro, but also because the themes in there are going to be the ones that I need to build on and develop answers to those sets of questions, but in a different way. So the purpose here is to talk about Kaletsky, and then by extension I'll talk about Lavoie and Godley and Taylor, and to some extent Goodwin, and some overlap that comes, because that'll provide us with a transition to the classical. Now, the first thing you notice about Kaletsky's work is a similarity to Keynes. I mean, these points are well known, but it's important to establish them first. In the short run, aggregate demand is assumed to have an autonomous component, which is investment, and an induced component, which is consumption, and the latter one responds to income. That means that if demand rises from the autonomous component, the consumption also rises, because the rise in demand raises income, and the income raises consumption, and you get the multiplier. That's the whole point of the multiplier, this successive set of interaction. Kaletsky also adopts Keynes's view that over the long run, investment responds positively to the gap between the prospective rate of profit and the rate of interest. So you notice that's something very important, that in the long run, investment responds to the difference between the profit rate and the interest rate. And that is the key argument in Keynes, but it also is a key argument in the classical tradition, especially in Marx, who makes it very explicit. Then when it comes to the interest rate in Kaletsky, he says it's determined by monetary factors, often which are, in Kaletsky's view, in the hand of the state. And the profit rate is determined by the wage share and the rate of capacity utilization. And that we're going to come back to that in a minute, about the relation between the profit share and the profit rate and the wage share. But the best way to think about that is that the profit rate is the profit over capital. That means if you divide profit by output, you get the profit share over the capital output ratio. But the profit share is 1 minus the wage share. So the profit rate depends negatively on the wage share. The wage share goes up, the profit share goes down, and the profit rate goes down. Then the other part is that capital to output can be thought of as capital to normal, or capital to capacity times divided by output over capacity. So capital to capacity is Harrod's famous variable, which measures technical change, the degree embodiment of capital in technology. And the capacity utilization rate is output over capacity. So the profit rate, in effect, depends negatively on the wage share, because 1 minus the wage share is in the numerator, depends negatively on the capital capacity ratio, because that's in the denominator. And it depends positively on the capacity utilization rate, because that's in the denominator to the denominator, so it comes up to the top. So another way to say that is that the profit rate is equal to the normal profit rate times the capacity utilization rate. The actual profit rate is equal to the profit share over the capital to capacity ratio, which can be thought of as a normal profit rate, and then you have the capacity utilization rate. And that means that if anything increases capacity utilization in the short run, it'll tend to increase the profit rate. The question is, what happens to capacity utilization if it rises above normal? What's the reaction of the system? And that's going to be one of the key features of the difference between a classical and a Keynesian and post-Keynesian approach. It's also interesting to note that in Kaletsky's original argument, he has a Keynesian idea of investment in the long run. But then he subsequently links investment to past investment and to current and past profits in a manner which, it turns out, is essentially the same as the idea that investment is driven by the incremental rate of profit in excess of the interest rate. So let me just Kaletsky says in this later work, 1968, says that aggregate investment depends positively on available finance. That is to say, if it's easier to get finance, it'll be easier to invest. One could also say it depends positively on the rate of finance, the cost of finance, which is the interest rate. So a lower interest rate will enhance investment. Now, that's very consistent with the idea that investment depends on the difference between the profit rate and the interest rate. So if finance is cheaper, then that gap becomes bigger and investment rises. So that's very similar to Keynes at this point. Depends also, he says, positively on the change in profit and negatively on the change in the capital stock. So if you see his verbal description, then you can say that Kaletsky's investment function is of the general form, a positive impact from profit, a positive impact from the change of profit, and a negative impact from the change in capital stock, which is the past investment. Okay? Now, that's very interesting, because this is virtually identical to the classical argument that the share of investment is a function of the rate of return on investment, net of the interest rate. So the rate of return on investment can be thought of as a change in profit over the change in capital, or the change in profit over investment. So the investment share depends on the change in profit over the change in capital. And that latter ratio is simply the incremental rate of profit. So the investment share depends on the incremental rate of profit net of the interest rate. And of course, if you write it that way, then it's easy to see that this can be rewritten in exactly the same general form, right? Because investment, I can multiply through by profit. So investment is equal to profit, positive impact, change of profit, positive impact, and the change in capital, a negative impact. So one way to think of Kaletsky's investment function is that it is really saying what I argue in the book is the driver of investment, which is the incremental rate of return. And there are many other elements in Kaletsky you'll see that will dovetail with the classical argument, though he himself writes this particular equation in linear form, partly because he's interested in testing it empirically. And in those days, and indeed until fairly recently, in order to test something, you run a linear regression. But if your hypothesis is that the investment share depends on the rate of return in investment, then obviously you can't write in linear form, because it's intrinsically a nonlinear relation. You can still test it, but you can't do it as in simple saying that it depends on the level of profit, change in profit, and the change in capital with coefficients A, B, and C, because that's not equivalent to this. So the general function form is equivalent, but the linear form is not. And this is an important point in a general way, that there is a strong tendency in econometrics to run everything as a linear regression, and on the assumption that it'll pick up the variables. But obviously, if your hypothesis is that it's a nonlinear relationship, which is by and large in any growth path, you can't talk about the level of the variable. You have to talk about its share or its rate of change. Either way, you can't assume that investment is a function of something. It's investment over capital, which is the rate of growth of capital, or investment over profit, which is a share of investment in profit. Because those variables are bounded on a growth path, but the level of investment is not bounded, because on a growth path it keeps rising, right? So if you want to characterize these things in a dynamic context, you have to normalize them, so to speak, by some variable. And that's a theoretical question, first of all. Typically now, people do normalize investment by dividing it by capital. But you can also divide it by output, or you can divide it by profit. All those, in a growth path, all those things are growing together. Okay? Any questions about that? So right away, we have the intriguing possibility that that Kaletsky's investment function can be written in a way that can be interpreted as his trying to get to a classical argument. Now, there's another thing, another overlap, which is very interesting. Kaletsky, unlike Keynes, incorporates class into his analysis. That is to say, he distinguishes between the income of workers and the income of capitalists, which he says is profit, broadly speaking. It's really labor and property income, a la Piketty, but at that level of abstraction, profit is taken to be the measure of property income. At a more concrete level, you'd have to distinguish between dividends, rents, interest, and the incomes that flow from partitioning these out, including stocks and bond interest rates and derivatives and all of that. But at this level, he takes profit to be property income and wages to be labor income. In the simplest case, he usually assumes that workers don't save, but in other cases, he allows for, and you can allow for, savings out of wages. Nothing intrinsically changes in the story, really, from that. Now, at one point, he says that investment decisions are strongly influenced by the internal finance of firms. It's not clear what that means, influence. You could say that investment depends on savings, not in the sense that the Keynesian sense that the level of, investment depends on savings rather than savings depends on investment as in the multiplier. Another way to think of that is that savings adapts to investment. And that's a point I'm going to come back to later. Think about this. Suppose this is a board meeting of a corporation and you're making presentations for your investment plans. At that same board meeting, you'll also be making presentations about your retained earnings, because your retained earnings are the business savings for your investment. So the idea that business savings is independent of business investment, given that it's done in every firm internally, simultaneously, makes no sense. And Kaletsky comes very close to saying that by saying that business savings are different from household savings. You might argue that the board meeting determines dividends and interests and all of that, and those goes out to people who then decide how much they want to save from it. But the business, but those dividends payments and so on come after you decide retained earnings. So profit gets divided into retained earnings and outpayments, and the outpayments become income of property owners, and that income may lead to savings of those property owners, and maybe you could argue that doesn't depend on investment directly, but it's impossible to argue that the investment of a firm doesn't depend, and that the savings of a firm doesn't depend on its own investment. Because, of course, the finance for the investment is a decision of the firm. It's a decision variable of the firm. Now, I'm going to come back to that point. It's going to play a big role. Kaletsky comes very close to saying that. And then, for just algebraic convenience and simplicity, he assumes that savings of business savings, which are, as he said, connected to investment decisions, and the savings of property households, property earning households, income households, are dependent on their property income. He merges all this together and says savings, business savings, and income of property recipients are proportional to profit. And in this step, he eliminates the endogeneity of the savings rate. Because by fixing it relative to profit, it is not capable reacting to the investment decisions. Investment will affect output, which will affect the savings level, but the savings rate is now suddenly exogenous. Again, this is like assuming here previously that the investment function is linear. When you think of it, there's no reason to do this. And of course, the reason is that algebraically it's simpler if you make the assumption that savings is proportional to profit. And that becomes a kind of critical assumption. But it turns out to give rise to a problem. And that's a problem I'm going to talk about as we go through. So in the end, he merges both types of savings and says that the savings of households are fixed proportional of wage, of, I'm sorry, savings of workers are fixed proportional wages, and the savings of firms plus capitalist households are fixed proportional profit. When you do that, then total savings, the total savings rate, which is savings over output, will depend on the savings rate of workers times the wage share plus the savings rate out of profits, which is of firms and capitalist households, times the profit share. And the profit share is just 1 minus the wage share. So the average savings rate will depend on the distribution between wages and profits. That's a key point. But this has another implication, which is that the savings rate is no longer now free to adjust to investment, because firms can invest in this framework. The investment of firms does not affect the savings rate unless it affects the distribution of income. From this point of view, the Kaletskyan multiplier is just like the Keynesian multiplier at this level. Equilibrium output is equal to autonomous consumption of work of households plus investment, which is dependent on the expected profit rate minus the interest rate, as in Keynes also. So this is not so different. But in Keynes, the savings propensity, which causes the multiplier, itself depends on the distribution of income. So that seems to be a characteristic difference between the basic Keynesian model and the basic Kaletskyan model. The next point is that interesting to note that in Kaletsky's original formulation of the theory of effective demand, he assumed pure competition. He did not assume markups. In other words, for his theory of effective demand, competition is just as good a foundation as monopoly power. In fact, that's how he started. And that's important because we already noted that Keynes does not accept the idea that his theory of effective demand depends on imperfect competition. He explicitly rejects that. In fact, Keynes famously rejects a paper by Kaletsky because he doesn't like Kaletsky's model, which leads to the idea that imperfect competition is a foundation for effective demand, and that capacity utilization can be whatever it is, which we'll see is one a necessary feature of post-Keynesian models, but not Keynes. And that's also important to understand. So one could argue that the very beginning of Kaletsky's excursion into effective demand, both Keynes and Kaletsky are founded on some notion of competition. And that one of the things I'm going to try to show you is that the notion of real competition fits perfectly well here. Now, once Kaletsky has included the wage shares and the wage shares themselves and the profit share into the story of the average savings rate and these other sub-variables, the savings rate of workers, the saving rate out of profits, are given as fixed, you then have to have a theory of the wage share. And this leads to the idea in Kaletsky that imperfect competition becomes this theory of the wage share. And that's a point that's not often emphasized, but think about that. Kaletsky says firms mark up over their prime costs. Prime costs is materials plus unit labor costs. So it's materials and wage costs per worker, right? They then create a price by adding a markup to that, a markup which is based on their monopoly power. Well, then, since prime costs is wages and materials can be broken into wages and materials of the materials, and then wages and of the first round, wages second round, and materials of the materials, you can see that this boils down to the price is a markup over direct and indirect wage costs. And so the profit share, which is the ratio of the markup to the total output, is determined by the markup, markup over price. That means that the wage share is also determined by the firm. And that's a very interesting outcome. If the wage share is determined by the markup, determined by firms, then real wages relative to productivity are determined by the firms. Now that is a very strong conclusion, which is inherent in post-Keynesian arguments of markup. That is to say, workers have no say on their own real wage. Because the wage share is a real wage over productivity. Capitalists determine the wage share, and they also determine productivity. Who does that? It's the firm. So the workers get the real wage that capitalists give them. I'm going to come back to that. But another implication of this kind of markup argument is that since a markup is based on prime costs, and prime costs are based essentially on direct and indirect wages, then price will reflect wages. Because if wages go up, unit labor cost goes up, direct and indirect unit labor costs, because prime costs will go up, because their wage component will go up. So materials costs will go up. That means that wages are the ultimate driver of the price level. Capitalists determine, fix a markup over wages, and if wages rise, then prices rise. That means that inflation in these arguments is ultimately rooted in the behavior of money wages. That's a very striking consequence, because it says that the prime cause of inflation is workers. Not because they want to do it, and it may not even. But by implication also, it should follow that deflation is also in the hands of workers. Because all workers do by setting a wage is to determine the price level. And indeed, the irony is that they can't change their real wage. In the strict equations of this argument, you can see that if the price reflects wages, and if wages go up, prices go up, then the real wage is given. And in fact, in Kaletsky's argument, we know that the wage share is determined by the markup, and the markup is given by the firm's monopoly power. Therefore, the real wage over productivity is determined by the firms. And since the firms determine productivity, the firms determine the real wage. So the workers' struggles disappear from this story, disappear. Kaletsky didn't like this implication of his own theory. He was aware of the implication. Maybe he'd been criticized. I don't know that literature well enough to who was attacking Kaletsky for making this argument. But essentially, Kaletsky certainly knew history well enough to know that workers' struggles over real wages have, over time, been associated with a rising real wage. It's not hard to argue that they're causing the rising real wage. Workers struggle for a higher standard of living. And with the force of and sometimes bloody struggles over time, they've managed to raise their real wage. Perhaps not faster than productivity, but at least to raise it. And you can find this historically in periods. You can track it. So Kaletsky's got a problem. His theory says that real wages are not determined by workers. And his observations say that workers have a big influence, or at least have an influence on real wages. So how is he going to try to reconcile the two? What he does near the end of his life is to raise the possibility that an increase in wages can lower the degree of monopoly. But that's the only thing that can cause wages to rise. If monopoly, the markup goes down, then the wage share rises. So now he's trying to build into his own story the idea that the monopoly markup is not monopoly alone. It's also labor fear markup, because if workers raise wages and firms are worried about the implication of that, then the wage increases by workers can reduce the degree of monopoly. Now, I find this a very weak argument, a very ad hoc argument, because, of course, the whole notion of monopoly power is not monopoly over labor, let's say, as in Marx. It's monopoly of one firm against another, of the monopoly in the market. But Kaletsky is faced with the difficulty that he has to come up with some story like this, because otherwise he cannot even accommodate the fact that workers' struggles do have an effect on the standard living of workers. You will see that in the classical argument, there's no such problem, because in fact the foundation of the argument is that the wage share is determined by the real wage is determined by workers' struggles, and the wage share then depends on what happens to productivity, and we're going to come back to how firms react to raise productivity if wages go up. But that doesn't mean that real wages come down. It means productivity goes up to keep the wage share in bounds. Now, if it is true that wages increases can reduce a degree of monopoly, then it's possible that a reduction in the unemployment rate, let's say through demand pumping, can lead to a higher money wage, but also to a higher real wage and a higher wage share, because a monopoly markup may fall. So now Kaletsky's argument allows space for a positive effect of aggregate demand on wages, not just on employment, but on wages and the wage share. And that gives rise in Kaletsky's argument, though he doesn't lay it out himself, but his attempt to incorporate the feedback between worker struggles, unemployment, and real wages leads to the possibility of three types of Phillips curves. Now think about that. Unemployment has an effect on wages, in the sense that higher unemployment would lead to a lower growth of real wages. And in Kaletsky's case, it would have to work through the markup. So higher unemployment would have to have some impact on the markup so that the rate of growth of money wages is reduced. That's a Phillips curve. That's the original Phillips curve by Phillips. So on the horizontal axis, you have unemployment. On the vertical axis, you have the rate of growth of money wages. But you could equally well argue that in Kaletsky's argument, you could say that what is affected by unemployment is real wages, because unemployment can affect money wages, which affect prices, but because of markup effect, the real wage actually can be affected. And lastly, you could argue that it affects the rate of change of the wage share, not just the rate of change of real wages. Because, again, productivity, if the real wages change in a particular way, unless productivity moves against that, it can cause the same effect in the rate of change of the wage share. So we have three possible Phillips curves. On the horizontal axis, unemployment rate. On the vertical axis, the rate of change of money wages, which is Phillips' original curve. The rate of change of money wages, real wages, which is the Phelps and Friedman Phillips curve with expectations built into it, and the rate of change, and it's also the Goodwin Phillips curve, and then the rate of change of the wage share, which I will call the classical Phillips curve, because that's very implicit in the argument in Marx about how reducing the reserve army of labor, which is to reduce the unemployment rate, increases the wage share and reduces the profit rate, and that causes a growth rate to fall, and that reduces the rate of growth of demand for labor, so the unemployment rate begins to rise again. Okay? So at this level of abstraction, we cannot select from Kaletsky's story which one of these three, but they're all compatible with the general modified Kaletskyan story that wage increases, possibly due to reduced unemployment, can lead to reduced unemployment can lead to wage increases, which could be nominal wage increases, real wage increases, or wage share increases. Okay? Now, the other half of this kind of argument would ask, what is the effect of wages on unemployment? So far, we've been saying if the unemployment gets reduced and wages rise, then Kaletsky's argument implies three possible Phillips curves. What about the effect of wages on unemployment? Neoclassical theory would say that higher wages tend to raise the unemployment rate. So wages go up, unemployment will go up, because wages are automatically at the full employment level. So if you put them above the full employment level, then you're going to have unemployment. And that's what brings everything back to the full employment level. But Kaletsky was also aware that in practice, real wages rising is not necessarily associated with higher unemployment. He certainly knew the empirical thing. And sometimes higher wages, real wages, are associated with higher unemployment. Sometimes they're associated with lower unemployment, and the causal sequence is not clear. So he doesn't want to tie to the neoclassical story that an increase in real wage will automatically make the unemployment rate go up and therefore bring that or undo that increase. So like Keynes, he wants to prevent the counter-argument that unemployment will cause real wages to fall. And if real wages fall, then more people will be employed and you'll come back to full employment. So unemployment is self-correcting. So he then proposes, for instance, that higher wages increase consumption demand of workers, whereas investment is slow to react to profitability, and therefore the initial effect of higher wages is to raise aggregate demand. Now you'll see that plays a big role in profit-led versus wage-led stories, which you can already see in here. So the initial effect would be to raise aggregate employment if wages are raised. So that's a very nice argument. It says that if workers get higher wages, then they'll also get higher employment because the aggregate demand from their higher consumption will cause more employment. So they get both. By raising wages, they get more jobs. And that's obviously against the neoclassical argument that raising wages will mean less jobs. And it would also raise capacity utilization because the raising wages would create a higher aggregate demand, which means output would go up at a given level of capital. It means that the utilization of that capital stock will go up, so capacity utilization will rise, which means the profit rate will rise on that ground. So we have these potentially already two possible opposing movements in Kaletsky's own argument, in this modified version. Raising real wages could create more jobs because consumption demand of workers will rise. It will reduce the profit share because the wage share will go up, and it'll reduce the profit share. But then capacity utilization is also going up, and that may negate that effect, so the profit rate doesn't necessarily have to be affected. So the next and key characteristic of Kaletsky's argument is that unemployment and excess capacity are normal. Now here he does need a theory of monopoly power in order to make this argument, because if he had started from the theory of pure competition, he would be stuck with the neoclassical argument that it leads to full employment. So his theory does require grounding for the idea that you have persistent unemployment and excess capacity, but more importantly, that the state can eliminate them by pumping up the system. That plays a key. Deficit spending directly adds to purchasing power, and in Kaletsky's argument, deficit spending would be self-financing because it would increase output and income through the multiplier, which would create new savings and eventually the savings would rise until they covered the sum of the budget deficit and the investment. Because in the expanded multiplier story, we had excess demand. If you abstract from the trade deficit and worker savings, then excess demand becomes I minus S plus G minus T. We derived that earlier. And then short equilibrium condition that E, which is excess demand, is equal to zero implies that savings, which is S times Y, is equal to the autonomous component, which is investment plus a government deficit. The government deficit is not fully autonomous because taxes may be viewed in one version to depend on income, but they can also be viewed in a lump sum tax as independent of income. It doesn't change the story at all. So in the simplest version, we have that if you increase anything on this side, then savings cannot catch up to investment except by increasing output, because the savings rate at any given distribution of income is fixed. But if that distribution of income is not altered, then savings will rise to cover, so to speak, the sum of investment and the government deficit. An equilibrium then will mean that the two sides will match. It's self-financing in that sense. Now, it could be argued that so as long as the savings rate out of profits is independent of the needs of investment, a rise in the budget deficit will raise output until savings rises sufficiently to absorb the new purchasing power coming from the government deficit. Now, I'm going to argue against this whole notion, but at least for now, it's important to note that Kaletsky also takes into account the possibility that this pumping up of the economy will raise interest rates. But he says, well, the state has proper tools, has monetary policy, so that it could negate the effect of a rising interest rate through monetary policy. And it could even lower the interest rate to pump up the system. And so you can see, again, the basic elements of the Keynesian argument. Deficit finance pumps up the system, and monetary policy can not only negate any interest rate pressure, but can even lower interest rate to further pump up the system. So the state has, and this is the ISLM in type of argument that we already encountered previously. The key thing for Kaletsky is that inflation should be not allowed to get out of control, because you keep the economy at functional full employment. That is, you can bring it close to where the unemployed people are the people who are going from one job to another. They are frictionally unemployed, so you keep it at full employment. And you keep it at full capacity utilization, but you don't push it beyond that. Now, notice that this is a very characteristic feature of the Keynesian arguments, post-Keynesian arguments, which is that inflation only comes about if you have full employment. A little bit of inflation, because on the Phillips curve, you know that inflation gets higher as you approach full employment. But inflation is essentially a full employment phenomenon. It's in the vicinity of full employment. And what doesn't make sense from this is that the unemployment rate could expand, so fewer people are employed, and inflation pressure could rise, because inflation pressure rises only if the unemployment rate contracts, not of an expense. You could also use redistribution of income from the rich to the poor to raise the average propensity to consume and to strengthen consumption demand. And you could manage the burden of interest payments in national debt by putting taxes on personal and business assets to pay for this debt. Sounds like Bernie Sanders, actually, doesn't it? Maybe he's read Kaletsky, who knows? Despite these policy possibilities in Kaletsky, Kaletsky himself is pessimistic about the political possibility of carrying out this process, about being able to impose taxes on high incomes and on business assets, and being able to redistribute income from the rich to the poor. And particularly, he is pessimistic about the possibility of maintaining full employment, because he argues that full employment removes one of the sources of power that capitalists have, which is the power to select people who are unemployed and therefore keep the working class in line. Unemployment plays a disciplining role. Very interesting if you look at it that way, because this is exactly what Phelps argues in his Nobel argument, which is that unemployment plays a disciplining role. And I don't know if anybody has ever tried to connect Phelps to Kaletsky, but Kaletsky's work was around, so to speak, in Cambridge, actually, and Phelps was in Cambridge, too, at one point. So it'd be an interesting thing to see that connection, Phelps and Kaletsky. Well, I already mentioned the connection of Phelps and Goodwin last time, too. So in the end, it's not very clear what to expect out of the Kaletskyan argument. On one hand, it would seem that inflation comes out of wages only. It would seem that workers have no influence on the real wage. It would seem that the state can maintain full employment, but can't determine the real wage, but it can determine full employment and the interest rate. But when you look more closely, then it's not so clear. Workers may be able to have an influence on the real wage because it may force capitalists to reduce their markup in face of the threat of more labor action. And so workers have an incentive, so to speak, to fight for higher wages. And on the other hand, the state may not be able to maintain a system at some socially desired level because of the political difficulties, including the possibility of full employment. Any questions about Kaletsky? You can see that this brings us quite naturally to post-Keynesian economics, which is where I want to go next. Now, post-Keynesian economics is a range of people who share certain beliefs and don't agree on other things. So let me first try to lay out what I think is their five central common characteristics. One, aggregate demand drives output. Very important point, because that's not so in the classical tradition. It's not so in the neoclassical tradition. But it is in the Keynesian and post-Keynesian tradition that aggregate demand is the driver of output and hence employment. Second, that money is endogenously created through the banking system. Now, that is not a characteristic feature of neoclassic economics, but it's an absolutely characteristic feature of Marx's argument, for instance, and Tuck and the banking school. So it's part of the classical tradition also. Third, that persistent excess capacity is normal. In other words, there's always room to expand. Now, here's the interesting point. I talked about this in this course in the beginning about the argument in Marx, I think it was this semester rather than last semester, that in argument in Marx that normal capacity utilization is the number of shifts that will give you the lowest cost Remember, we had those a cost curve, and the normal one was a point where the lowest cost. Now, that implies that firms are never fully utilized. They are utilized at the most profitable competitive level, which is a lower cost, but there's always room for them to expand. That does not imply that they have excess capacity. So the idea of the Kaletskyan and Keynesians that the elasticity of output in capitalism is a sign of excess capacity does not follow. In fact, this is a point Marx very specifically makes, which I believe I cited, which is that capitalism is always capable of expansion because it utilizes capital only to the point where it's most profitable, not the point of the maximum physical capacity. Do people remember that, or should I go back to that diagram? Yeah? Let me, it's not clear that you do remember that. Some people are looking puzzled, others are looking dismayed. Okay. This is a sort of a typical empirical cost curve, but it's also the cost curve of a classical argument. And you have here the average cost. You have the dotted line, which is, average variable cost, which is prime cost, which for simple mapping to Keynesian arguments have made constant in the first shift, and then it rises to a higher prime cost in the second shift because you have to pay workers to work at night, and you have to heat more, and so on. So you need light and heat at night in most countries. So that average variable cost, which is the prime cost, rises. On the other hand, fixed costs typically decline. And this is to the first shift. There may be some changeover costs in the second shift, but then they continue to decline. So the sum of average fixed costs and average variable costs is the black line, which is the average cost. And that average cost is typically declining until the end of one shift, maybe the first or second shift or something. Then it rises, and then it comes back down again. So it may be at the end of the second shift lower than at the end of the first shift. I've shown it here, end of the first shift is the lowest, but it could be the other way. The point is that they are typically room for increases in output by having longer working day, speed up, more shifts, even though they're not the optimal combination in the long run, but in the short run you can do it. And therefore, capitalism is always capable of expanding, even if it is at normal capacity utilization before the impetus of aggregate demand. So the fact that that it's capable of expanding does not imply excess capacity. Whereas in Kaletsky's vision, excess capacity, full capacity means stuck at some physical limit, and therefore the fact that capitalism does expand implies that it must be at excess capacity. Many post-Keynesians essentially make that same argument. They essentially reduce excess capacity to non-profitable capacity. Non-profitable in the long run, because competition selects firms according to their lowest costs. That's a key feature of the notion of real competition. And so operating on the lowest part of the cost curve is, in fact, the thing that keeps you in the game, if your costs are low. If they're higher than others, it doesn't really matter. Then you're in trouble. OK? Is that point clear? The fourth point in Kaletsky's argument, in post-Keynesian arguments in general, is that unemployment is also normal. Not only excess capacity, but unemployment. Now, that's very interesting because, of course, in the classical argument, there's also the idea that unemployment is normal. That's a reserve army of labor. We're going to come back to that. But it's not the same as the Keynesian idea, because the Keynesian idea is unemployment is a normal observation, but it can be removed. In the classical one, it cannot be removed. So that's a different, in the long run, is a different story, so to speak. And so that brings up The fifth argument, which is essential to Keynesian, post-Keynesian arguments especially, which is that the state can bring capacity utilization up to normal, and it can bring employment up, unemployment down to a low level. It can eliminate involuntary unemployment and involuntary excess capacity. So the state plays the role of bringing the system into a point where you have not only normal capacity utilization, but also full employment. And that characteristic is probably the central one of Keynesian post-Keynesian arguments, which is that the state is the ultimate regulator of capitalism, that it has the power. Now notice that if the state is the ultimate regulator, then the existence of unemployment, and indeed the existence of inflation, is the fault of the state. Because the state has the power to fix it. Is that point clear? It is very striking to me, this way of looking at things. And I've told this story before, maybe told it last semester or two for that matter. But I was once in the audience of a TV show, which was run by William Buckley, a famous conservative commentator, very conservative. And he had a show called Firing Line. And on that show, they had two sets of people who were arguing. One were conservatives about budget deficits and inflation, and the other were post-Keynesians. And what was interesting is that the post-Keynesians said, Keynesians argue that inflation is caused by workers, because by raising their wages, it's completely consistent with the argument here. And the conservatives said, no, it's caused by the state printing too much money, again, consistent with their. And the post-Keynesians would defend the state and in effect attribute inflation to workers, and the conservatives were defending workers and attributing inflation to the state. And one of the conservatives, who was a senator from upstate New York, said, I'm a working class man, I grew up in working class neighborhoods, and it's an absolute insult to workers to say that workers are the cause of inflation. And the post-Keynesians going, no, it's an insult to the state to say, but that's the logic of the theory, it's consistent with the theory. So with this general rubric of post-Keynesian theory, I want to begin now talking about specific post-Keynesians. I'll try and get through as many of them as I can here, but let's start with Davidson, Paul Davidson. He's sort of the dean of the American Keynesian wing, post-Keynesian wing. And he divides post-Keynesian economics into two groups, the American camp, like Victoria Chick, Minsky, even though she's actually in England, Minsky, Eichner, Kregel, Basil Moore, Sidney Weintraub, and Paul Davidson himself, who put a lot of emphasis on money and financial processes. And then the European camp, like Harcourt, Kahn, Kaldor, Kaletsky, Robinson, and various Keynesians coming from Sraffa, whom Davidson sneers at, or at least sniffs at. He says the Keynesians coming from Sraffa are, quote, still cling to variants of classical economics because they focus on the behavior and functioning of the real economy while ignoring or at least downplaying monetary and financial implications. So from Davidson's breakdown, there's those people who think monetary and financial things are the central variables, and then those European Keynesians who focus on real variables, profit rate, wage rate, and their trade-off in Sraffa, and so on. And therefore, by Davidson's point of view, put insufficient emphasis on money and financial variables. In Davidson's own view, post-Keynesian economics rests on five propositions. First, that demand has an autonomous component in the short run. And that central autonomous component, of course, is investment. And the autonomy of investment comes from the fact that credit can make spending independent of current income, current funds. So the existence of credit is what accounts for the short-run autonomy of investment. Firms can finance investment without having to save the money, even collectively. And secondly, households can finance some amount of consumption by dipping into their reserves or borrowing. Second, a capitalist economy is money-driven. Businesses invest money in labor, materials, and machines with the intention of making more money, the whole process being conducted in terms of money contracts for present and future delivery. Now, when you read Davidson saying that, I think, oh, well, I hate to say this, but this had been said before, MCM prime. And Davidson doesn't, like many of the American Keynesians, keeps Marx at great distance. Now, coming and up and in the McCarthy period in the United States, where the mention of Marx was something horrendous and horrible and could actually lead to job loss and all kinds of other things, it's not surprising that the post-Keynesians, American post-Keynesians, keep Marx much further away than the British and European post-Keynesians. Third, money is endogenous because it is credit-driven, and that money has real effects on production, growth, and employment. For instance, a credit-driven injection of purchasing power, even if it's just from households borrowing money, or firms borrowing money to invest, households borrowing money to consume, creates increased demand, and that increased demand creates increased employment and may increase other things such as wages, real wages. So money is not neutral. Now, the reason money is not neutral is because output and employment are not stuck at full employment. Therefore, an increase in aggregate demand can increase real variables. And that's the key implication of saying that there is always room in the system to respond to aggregate demand. So this has nothing to do with money illusion, but the fact that increased money expenditures will lead to real output changes and changes in employment. And finally, Davidson himself puts a lot of emphasis on the idea that you cannot talk about the future in terms of probabilities. Because the future, as he says, is non-ergodic. Now, an ergodic process, as he describes it, is a process in which the time average of future outcomes are not persistently different from the time average of past outcomes. In other words, though the past is not an exact indication of what can happen in the future contains the same patterns as the past. It's ergodic in that specific sense. The time patterns, time averages of future outcomes are roughly similar to the time averages of past outcomes. And therefore, you cannot define the future in terms of risk, because risk is about the weighing of the probability of future outcomes. But if the future outcomes are not like the past, how are you going to know what the probabilities are of future outcomes? So he opposes the idea of expectations, rational expectations, because for rational expectations to hold, the future must be like the past. It must be capable of being understood. And the subjective distribution of future outcomes must be equal to the objective ones. In other words, the people holding it must not only have the ability, must not only have a situation in which the future can be understood in terms of some prior process, but also their subjective judgments must be roughly correct. They must be similar to the objective ones. This in turn leads Davidson to argue that since the capitalism and future in general is non-ergonic, one cannot even form rational expectations, so that the whole theory of rational expectations falls apart. It also explains for him why you have to have liquid assets, why money is necessary, for instance, because since you don't know what's going to happen in the future, money is a way of having some safety about the possible outcomes. And that's why when fear of the future, of the uncertain future, increases, there's a reversion to liquidity. And lastly, Davidson argues, like almost all post-Keynesians do, that policy can strive for full employment and reasonable price stability. And he says it also should seek to make markets more efficient and more directed towards a social interest. Okay, any questions about this? You can see how this comes out from the main features. And so there's some differences you can already see in Davidson, the emphasis on ergodic, non-ergodic processes, and the attack on rational expectations, true fundamental uncertainty. But ultimately, the state can make things happen in a desirable, socially desirable way. Now, Godley and Taylor, Wynne Godley and Lance Taylor, fall within what might be called the Kaletskyan structuralist wing of the post-Keynesian tradition. And they share many of these attributes that Davidson has, but they also put more emphasis on stock flow accounting, consistent stock flow accounting. Though Taylor, who is by far the stronger theorist, makes the point that stock flow accounting doesn't make it particularly Keynesian or post-Keynesian because every theoretical framework is capable of being put within a stock flow consistent framework. So to say that you are stock flow consistent doesn't mean anything per se, except that you are stock flow consistent. You can be a neoclassical and be that. You can be a post-Keynesian. You can be different types of post-Keynesian. And surely you can also be classical. Marx, you might argue, the scheme to reproduction is a stock flow consistent framework. And in fact, if you ever read the discussion in Marx of money and physical stocks in the schemes of reproduction, which is a verbal description, not the ones with the balance equation, but his description of how these things flow, you'll see that he precisely shows that they are stock flow consistent. Because at the end of the reproduction process, you end up with the same stocks as before. And that's a consistency. It maintains the stocks. Both of members of this structuralist wing believe that aggregate demand drives aggregate supply, that prices reflect costs via monopoly markups. But then they diverge only in the sense that they focus on different aspects of this common framework. Wynne Godley was always involved in the construction of what he called small-scale macroeconomic simulation models. Small-scale, in his case, meant 30 to 90 equations. The Levy model is 430 or some on that order. So that, but he had always constructed these consistent models, which later began to incorporate stock flow. Taylor has been much more concerned with the explicit links to the foundations of the theory and to contrast with orthodox economics. Godley didn't spend much time criticizing orthodox economics or even targeting it. His time was spent on building a story, so the macroeconomic story. But Taylor is probably the leading PK voice in theoretical discussions and on the practice of economic development. Godley focused on the advanced countries, US and UK primarily, whereas Taylor, of course, has a huge influence in Latin America and in Asia. Now, they differ in certain ways. Godley always started with markup pricing, but his markup story begins with markups on normal costs. And the normal cost story comes from the studies done in Oxford, in the Oxford Economic Research Group, which led to a series of papers about by Andrews and by Hall and Hitch, who said that basically firms operate at that point of lowest capacity utilization. That's their normal cost. So from Godley's point of view, normal cost is a reference because the system must come back to normal cost. So at least firms seem to have a pricing that depends on normal cost. So in Godley's version, the markup is added to normal cost. And this turns into a markup on unit labor costs at normal capacity because, of course, prime costs are themselves labor costs plus materials of the materials and so on. So you can get rid of the materials element and you have, at the aggregate level, a markup on unit labor costs, direct and indirect. One thing of Godley that's different is his notion of cost includes the interest rate. Now, I've argued last semester, and I will argue again here, that the interest rate is not a cost. It is something that firms have to pay for money they borrowed, but the cost of production is not affected by the interest rate. In Godley's argument, it is part of the cost of production. So that means, from Godley's point of view, if interest rates go up, costs go up. And if costs go up, then prices go up at any given markup. And this allows Godley to explain the correlation between the level of prices and the level of the interest rate. Remember, I spent some time on that talking about the finding of Took, that the price level and the interest rate level move together in a broad sense. And I derived it last semester from a different argument, which is that the interest rate is determined by costs of banking plus a normal profit, but the costs of banking depend on the price level. So if the interest rate reflects the price of production of banking, as prices rise, the price of production of banking rises, and the nominal interest rate will rise. And that correlation comes from the profit rate equalization story, not from the fact that interests are part of costs. Interests, in this sense, reflect profit rate equalization on costs. In any case, in the modern post-Keynesian tradition, Godley treats the normal interest rate and nominal interest rate and exchange rates as being fixed by the state. Now, I would argue that's simply a sign that they don't have a theory of the interest rate. Because clearly the state does fix the interest rate sometimes in history, but capitalist history extends long before central banking and long before central banking policies to intervene in the exchange rate, in the interest rate and the exchange rate, by the way. So you have to have a theory of the market process in order to know when and how much the state is, in fact, influencing thing. You could say in New York City that there are some rules that affect rents. Rent stabilization is a rule that affects rents, or rent control. But it would be silly to say that the rents in New York City are determined by rent stabilization and rent control, because there's a huge market of uncontrolled rents. And even before rent stabilization, there was rent. So you have to explain rents first in order to know why the state is stepping in to prevent rents from rising too fast. And that's a different explanation of the effect of the state on rents than the argument that rents are determined by the state. Is that point clear? So for interest rates also, you have to have a theory of interest rates. And for exchange rates, you have to have a theory of exchange rates. You can't just simply make the state as the actor, because that's a way of getting around the fact that you don't have a theory. Again, markup pricing in Godley's hands translates into a wage-driven theory of inflation. That comes straightforward. But in Godley's hands, this becomes a conflict-driven theory of inflation. It's very similar to the argument made by Bob Rothorn in the late 1960s, as I recall, late 1970s, because I was there at that time when Bob thought he had got the answer to inflation, and it was a conflict theory. And the answer comes about this way. Workers struggle for a money wage, in light of a desired standard of living, and therefore a desired real wage. Firms, on the other hand, have a markup based on their monopoly power. If workers struggle for the wage, creates a real wage, and hence a wage share, which is below the firm's desired markup, then the firms will raise the markup, and that'll push the wage share back down. And so there's an intrinsic conflict between the goals of labor, trying to create a particular standard of living or share of wages in output, and the goal of capital, which is to create a particular share of profit in output. And those goals are expressed through rising money wages and rising prices, the only two variables that both sides immediately influence. And therefore, you could have conflict-driven inflation. So from this point of view, inflation can give rise to, wage increases can give rise to inflation, and they may trigger more increases in prices, which then cause workers to raise their wage further. And obviously, if nominal wages are indexed to the price level, then inflation from this point of view becomes intrinsically built in. Everybody follow that? It's a very common argument in Latin America that inflation comes from indexing because money wages automatically rise when prices rise, so therefore that causes prices to rise still more. And this is obviously an unstable process, so that explains what seems like rising and maybe hyperinflation in Latin America. What people never mention is that the algebra of this argument also implies that if workers lower wages, this will lead to unstable deflation for the same reason. And that gives you a clue as to the difficulty with the argument, which is that it only picks up one side at times of inflation, but where is that deflation in the 40 years in Latin America, or for many other countries for that matter? I would argue that the key thing here is that really inflation is not driven by wage. It's driven by conflict between capital and labor, perhaps, but it's not driven by wage and markup conflict. And I'm going to come back to that. The next point is that capacity utilization in Godley, as in Taylor, is a free variable. And what do I mean by that? I mean by that that output rises that in the Kaletskyan and Keynesian story, the equilibrium level of output depends on these autonomous components, autonomous consumption and investment determined by long-run profitability forces, and a fixed savings rate, though the savings rate can vary with the wage share, but it's fixed if you have a wage share. That means that if you increase aggregate demand, and you can add a G plus G minus T up in here until you get the government side of the story, if you pump this side up, then output will rise. But if output rises in the short run, capacity utilization will rise because capital stock takes time to increase. And if capacity utilization rises, then according to Harrod, if that rises above normal, investment will rise. And so this is the source of what looks like a Herodian instability. You pump up output, it raises capacity, raises output, it therefore raises capacity utilization, but investment depends also on capacity utilization, not just on profitability. So if you raise capacity utilization, you raise the observed rate of profit, and investment will rise, in which case this part will rise even more, so you get a feedback loop. And in Harrod, it looks like that feedback loop is unstable, and he shows it in a simple way. I show in the book that it's not. It's very easy to show that it's in a growth path, this is perfectly stable. But anyway, Keynesians ignore the key point, which is that capacity utilization as a free variable is a form of stock flow inconsistency. if firms get capacity utilization above normal, you'd expect their investment to react to that. If it's below normal, you expect the investment to react the other way, to reduce investment. To assume that investment is independent of capacity utilization is to introduce an inconsistency in the stock flow story, because you're basically saying the stock of capital is not consistent. I'm sorry, the stock of the flow of output is not consistent with the stock of capital. Now, Godley and others are aware that the problem of the Keynesian story then is that capacity utilization can be anything. If investment is fixed and autonomous consumption is fixed, then there is a certain level of output, and in any given capital stock, it'll give you a level of capacity utilization. That level of capacity utilization might be 20%, it might be 50% of normal, it might be normal, it might be 150% of normal. This story depends on it not affecting the other variables. Otherwise, they're no longer exogenous in the sense that the Keynesians need. And indeed, if you, Godley and some others, which I'm going to come back to five times, Dutt and Lavoie, argue that, well, capacity utilization, normal, what does normal mean? Normal is what you're used to. So if your capacity utilization goes up, you'll become used to a higher level of capacity utilization, and so the normal will be that. The trouble with that, of course, is it implies that that normal has nothing to do with the desired level of utilization of capital. It is whatever it is. And it's been very severely criticized on the simple grounds that if you have 20% capacity utilization, can you assume that firms will continue to invest and expand capital stock when 80% of their capital stock is not being used already? Conversely, if you have 150% capacity utilization, can you assume that firms will not expand their capital stock given that they need more? They're going off into higher cost regions? So the answer is you can't get around that. And this is a real problem for post-Keynesian theory, because the idea that capacity utilization is a free variable is central to the key theorems of post-Keynesian economics. I'm going to have to skip a little bit here about Godley. It's a shame, but I need to get to that part. Let me get to Taylor. Taylor is probably the preeminent voice in the post-Keynesian structural tradition, and his focus on economic development, which is I have to leave out at the moment here. But his structuralism aims to model interaction among agents in the context of institutions and in the light of what he calls stylized facts. Output is taken to be determined by aggregate demand. That's a standard Keynesian, post-Keynesian thing. And aggregate demand is driven by exogenous investment and government spending and imports. Again, standard Keynesian story. You can take in the story of aggregate demand, if you leave out exogenous consumption, you can add that here. So this could have a CA plus an I plus G minus T. But if G is proportional, if T is proportional to output, it's say some tau times Y, then you can move that over here and you get S plus tau times Y is equal to I plus G. Same thing for exports, be autonomous on this side, but imports are proportional to Y. So you have S plus tau plus M on this side is I plus G plus X. That's a standard Keynesian breakdown. You have some things that affect the multiplier, the S plus tau plus M, small m, and then you have the I plus G plus X, which is the autonomous component. Savings rate are typically given in a Kaletskyan way in Taylor's arguments that savings rate of workers are different from the saving rate of capitalists. Sometimes workers' savings are assumed to be zero. And this is why output does all the adjustment. If savings did all the adjustment, there'd be no multiplier. I mean, think about that. If you had here SY is equal to I plus G plus T, and this part went up, but the small s went up, then the I wouldn't need to go up, right? So the idea that the multiplier is an effect, that the aggregate demand has an effect on output, comes from the assumption that the savings rate is fixed, assumed to be fixed. And that plays a very important role in the classical argument, because you'll see from the beginning that they don't make that assumption. They make the opposite assumption, that savings is linked to investment, that the savings of businesses are linked to investment. And that turns out to be enough to overturn all of these things. Investment, the interest rate is typically given also in these stories. Social accounting matrices are built in, but as I said, capacity utilization is treated as a free variable so that an important stock flow inconsistency is built into the model. And investment is generally taken to respond positively to profitability, sometimes to animal spirits that depend on profit rates and interest rates. Taylor develops over many years different versions of these models, which bring out some features. In one of them, he uses the ratio of the profit rate to the interest rate, which is very interesting because that's the Keynesian issue. The profit rate minus the interest rate. If you divide that by the interest rate, it's profit rate over the interest rate minus one. So the key variable is the profit rate over the interest rate. So that's a way of capturing the idea that investment depends on the difference between the profit rate and the interest rate. And so it's a basic argument in Kaletsky, Keynes, and Marx also. At the most abstract level in structuralist theory, wage struggles cannot affect the real wage because if money wages increase, prices increase. And so therefore, the real wage cannot increase. However, when you talk about conflict-driven wage price increases, then you can have a process in which real wages can increase. And this is exactly the whole notion of conflict-driven inflation, not conflict-driven real wages, a wage share, but conflict-driven inflation. A local wage increase will lead to firms raising their prices because they keep their markups the same, so costs will rise, and these will filter into the costs of other firms, so they will raise their prices. As I said, what's strange about this argument is that in the extreme form of wage indexation, you should have two possibilities. One is that a rise in wages will trigger runaway inflation. The other is a drop in wages will trigger runaway deflation. But that second aspect is not emphasized at all. Now, that leads to a very central issue in the Taylor structuralist argument, which is the idea that the effect of a rise in the wage share on growth is ambiguous. And it's ambiguous in the following sense, that a rise in the wage share increases consumption per unit output, increases aggregate demand of workers. On the other hand, a rise in the wage share decreases the profit share, which reduces investment and reduces the consumption demand of capitalists, all those people who depend on profit as the source of their property income. So from that abstract level, the effect could go either way. And that leads Taylor and people working with him to say, well, you could have what's wage-led growth. You increase the wage share, and the net balance effect is growth rises. Or you could have profit-led growth, which is you increase the wage share, the profit share goes down, and growth goes down. And those both appear to be possible. You can even get a profit squeeze at the top of the cycle when wage share rises, and it squeezes profits and then brings everything down. Similarly, the effect of exchange rate devaluations are also viewed as ambiguous. They can go, if you have a devaluation, it increases the price of imports, which can reduce real wages also, because some part of worker standard living comes from wage goods, and those prices will rise and reduce workers' consumption. So a devaluation can have a contractionary effect. On the other hand, the fall in real wages raises the profit share, which stimulates investment and profit-related demand. So then that could be expansionary, and either effect could obtain. So everything is local and concrete on those effects. I'm going to skip over Taylor's very interesting translation of Goodwin's long-run real wage Phillips curve into a short-run real wage capacity utilization curve. But I treat it in some depth in the book. One important point is that Taylor, like every post-Keynesian, treats capacity utilization as a free variable. By free variable, I mean that implicitly and formally in the theory, it can be anything. And there's no pressure, no force to bring it back to normal. And this means, in effect, that the ambiguity that comes about from these different things come about in part because there's nothing that makes capacity utilization return to normal. That is to say, investment does not move in such a way as to expand capacity if capacity utilization is above normal, and to reduce capacity if it's below normal. One of the points that Taylor makes is an important point, is he emphasizes the difference in his method and those of the orthodoxy. Mainstream theory, he says, is deductive, where structuralism starts from the observed phenomena, what is out there, and then works backward to a theory. One could argue, really, that this is the essence of all the classical tradition also, starting from analyzing capitalism as it exists, and then working out the fundamental properties from there. But structuralism rejects the notion of a general theory because, in Taylor's view, it would lead to a one-size-fit-all policy prescription. For example, he says, orthodox economics sees inflation as money-driven while structuralists see it as cost-driven. But typically, inflation goes hand-in-hand with some degree of money supply growth, so in a structuralist model, you can have room for both, the money supply part and the cost part. So structuralist theories, from that point of view, he says, can be tailored to fit an economy's specific institutions. Each economy's inflation is sui generis and context-specific. Some blend of the two approaches has to be designed to fit the situation at hand. So in the end, you can have a money supply-driven growth and a wage struggle-driven money supply-driven inflation and wage struggle-driven inflation, and which one is appropriate depends on the concrete circumstances. Now, I'm going to argue against that. I want to argue throughout that you need a general theory, but I want to make the important point that a general theory is not the same thing as a fixed set of outcomes. A general theory is a framework within which concrete factors, it does not imply one-size-fit-all policy. It says that you move from the abstract to the concrete by introducing concrete factors and seeing how the general forces manifest themselves. And that's not the same thing as saying you could have some monetarism and some wage inflation. But I'm going to come back to that because I'm going to have to show you how it's possible to have a general theory of profit-driven growth of and profit-driven inflation. On the same processes. So let me summarize the general themes in post-Keynesian theory. First and foremost, aggregate demand drives production. This requires that investment be essentially independent of savings, not just in the short run, but in the long run. Because if in the long run investment responds or to savings, then of course you don't have the Keynesian story. The money supply is endogenously fueled by credit, private bank credit. Prices are formed by monopoly markups on costs. Inflation is caused by conflicting claims between workers and firms. And the interest rate is determined by the central bank. And private bank rates are determined by markups on the central bank rate. So here they have a theory of the interest rate spread. Banks are monopolists like anyone else, and they mark up their costs, and so their interest rate depends on the base rate of interest, which is set by the state. So the state is the ultimate regulator of the spectrum of interest rates. And that leads ultimately to the paradox of thrift and the paradox of costs, which are two key features, as Lavoie points out, of the post-Keynesian story. The paradox of thrift is essentially another word for the multiplier. If you have equilibrium output is equal to autonomous consumption, autonomous investment over the savings rate, then if you save more, I'm sorry, if you, what do I want to say? If you save more, the savings rate rises and the output falls relative to its trend. So being more thrifty leads to reduction of output and employment, which is the opposite of the classical, neoclassical argument that being more thrifty raises the rate of growth, and it doesn't actually affect unemployment, which is always at full employment, but it can raise the rate of growth. Any questions about that? That's another way of stating the multiplier. The paradox of cost comes about from the fact that the wage share is really the equivalent of unit labor costs. The wage share is the wage times labor over output, and that's the wage over output per worker. And the small y is just value added per worker. But if you divide both sides by the price level, then you have the real wage as a product wage, real wage in relative to product prices. And you have output per worker in real terms. That's productivity. So the wage share is the ratio, is real unit labor costs, the ratio of the real product wage to the productivity per worker. But then a rise in real unit labor costs implies that the wage share has gone up, and the wage share going up implies what? I went too far. Hang on a second. Went the wrong way. So if the wage share rises, these real unit labor costs rise, then a greater proportion of income is going to labor. And since labor saves less than property income recipients, the savings rate goes down. And from the paradox, from the multiplier, that means if it goes down, output goes, that can't be right. Wait a minute. Average, this is a mistake. The average savings rate, I did type something wrong here. Let me just work it out. The wage share rises, so the savings rate of workers is lower, so the wage savings rate will fall, and that should give you the output rises relative to trend. So this is a typo, output rises. Trend. To put it another way, if the wage share falls, then output will fall relative to trend. Okay, so I've got it backwards here. I don't know exactly how I did that, but anyway. So it should be a fall in real unit labor cost implies a lesser proportion of income, or you can simply say output rises relative to trend. Okay? Yes, it ushers in the paradox of thrift, but this sentence, which I added just before class, is backwards. Output rises relative to trend. Okay? Okay, I made the point. And the last point is that what looks like wage-led and profit-led growth as two opposite outcomes can be understood from a classical point of view as two parts of the sequence. Because if you have a rise in the real wage and it has a positive impact on worker consumption and a negative impact on the normal capacity profit rate, then even if capacity utilization rises, as investment rises and brings you back to the normal capacity profit rate, the normal growth rate will go down. And in effect, what you get is a wage-led growth in the beginning, but a wage-led growth slowdown later. So it'll appear like a profit-led growth, because the profit rate will go down, so the growth will go down. And that appears like a profit-led growth rate. But these are, in fact, simply sequential movements in the same process, short run and medium run, let's say. So from this point of view, if pumping up wages, pumping up employment, Keynesian policy, pumps up output, pumps up employment, raises the wage relative to productivity, and the wage share rises, the profit share goes down, profit rate, normal profit rate goes down, then capacity utilization, even if it's gone up above normal, is brought back down. And so you have a slowdown in growth. And in effect, you've pumped up the system in the short run and gained output and therefore increased growth in the short run. But you've also slowed down the growth of the system at the same time. So the level goes up, but the growth rate goes down. And what you gain in the short run, you lose subsequently from the same action. Not at some time in the future when you're dead, but in fact, the today's short run is yesterday's long run. So you have to keep in mind that you're already experiencing the consequences of previous actions. And that obviously has implications for policy. And that's going to be one of the central themes here. Keynesian policy's effectiveness is therefore limited by its effect on profitability, which, if you think about it, is not a terribly complicated statement, but it doesn't appear in Keynesian story. Keynesians are adamant in their refusal, according to Lavoisier, to accept the notion that the long run is in any way constrained by supply. The principle of effective demand is always relevant both in the short run and the long run. And so even if the effect of the output growth has an effect on employment, the natural rate of growth in the Herodian sense, which depends on the rate of growth to maintain a particular level of employment or unemployment, that will adapt to the rate of growth of effective demand. So everything ultimately has to be determined by effective demand. Now, this is exactly the difficulty or difference between the Keynesian argument and the classical one, though it's not so obvious what that difference is, because in the classical argument, you will also have the argument that unemployment is a self-restoring phenomena. Not in the Friedmanite sense, but it's self-restoring. And then the question is, how can you have a reserve army of labor which is fed by capitalist reactions and yet not have growth limited by the availability of labor? And we will come back to that. We show that those two statements are perfectly consistent. So I'm going to show in the subsequent, in what we're going to begin next time, to show that it's possible to explain the positive impact of aggregate demand, which the Keynesians focus on, and yet put it within a framework that also shows how a normal rate of capacity utilization can be restored, and also the possibility of a negative feedback between the wage share and the profit rate, which generates a persistent rate of involuntary unemployment. So we will see that you can incorporate the Keynesian story in the short run without any difficulty. It follows quite naturally and grounded in a theory of real competition, but the long-run implications are quite different because profitability asserts itself in the long run. And so you have to be careful what the impact is on profitability. I remind you, go back and look at that chapter where I talked about the Phillips curve and where we saw the enormous impact on profitability that took place. The enormous discrepancy between inflation and unemployment that took place that undid Keynesian economics. So we're going to return to that and show can be explained in a perfectly sensible way by now moving next time to the classical story of profit-driven growth with room for aggregate demand and deficit spending.